First of all, I thank Professor Gopinath for giving me an opportunity to address this gathering. Thank you. For last few years, I have been working on Panini and the relevance of theories of Shaabdabodha as well as Panini's Ashtadhyayi from natural language processing point of view. So what I am going to present today is my observations and my understanding of the theories of Shaabdabodha and its relevance from computational perspective. So in short, we are developing a computational tool or rather a computational parser for analyzing Sanskrit texts. So it all started with I wanted to read and understand Leelavati, but since I didn't have good knowledge of Sanskrit, I found it a bit difficult to understand it. Then I thought, why not build a tool which will assist me in understanding these texts, Sanskrit texts, and I started then developing morphological analyzers, parsers, etc. for Sanskrit. So while developing these, I always kept one thing in mind. We already have the theories of Shaabdabodha, and Panini has given almost exhaustive grammar. So I always try to stick to them, use them, and then on the basis of that develop the tools. So of course, tools have certain limitations. What are the limitations, etc.? Those things will come up when I present the things. Language, as all of us know, is a means of communication, and communication is a two-way process. Speaker expresses his thoughts through a language string, which is a generation process, which generate a language string from our thoughts. And listener deciphers the language string into underlying encoded thoughts. So it is the process of analysis. Panini has given almost exhaustive grammar for then prevalent Sanskrit, and this grammar deals with the generation process, starting with the thoughts arriving at the surface form from form of a sentence. And this process is almost deterministic. I say almost deterministic because there are certain cases where Panini says, yes, this or this, both the forms are possible. And all the choices are guided by the semantic or pragmatic conditions. And finally, we get a deterministic one or at the most two strings. Shaabdabodha, on the other hand, is the process of understanding, and it involves analysis of a given utterance. So naturally, there is a non-determinism involved here. Now, why this non-determinism? This non-determinism is because we have, when generating a string, we have multiple inputs giving rise to the same string. So when we analyze, when we revert back, then we have the non-determinism involved. And this non-determinism is at different levels. When we do the sandhi vicheda, there is non-determinism. At morphological analysis, there is non-determinism. When we decide the karaka role, again there is a non-determinism. Just to give an example, we have this savarna dirgha sandhi where a plus a becomes a plus a will also become a. So when we have a and we have to cut it into two strings, then it can be, there are four possibilities, either both short or one short, one long, or both long. So of course, the Indian writers, they have used this to generate various shlesha texts also. Then at morphological analysis level, when a word is given, what is its analysis? For example, devabhyam, we know that there are three possible analysis of this. Okay. Deciding the karaka role, again we have ambiguity, or when a meaning of a word is to be decided, we know that there are several words which have more than one meanings. So in such cases, what are the guiding principles, how we arrive at the correct meaning of the given text. And Indians were aware of this problem of ambiguity, non-determinism in natural languages, and it was in Kumaril Bhatt's in Tantra Vartika, he mentions three factors. These factors are Akanksha, Yogyata and Sannidhi, which will help in understanding the meaning of a sentence or the correlation between words. So, of course, after that, Tatparya was also added to this. So, there are now four factors, Akanksha, Yogyata, Sannidhi and Tatparya, and these four factors help us in understanding a given text. Akanksha or the expectancy, for this there is a Gemini Sutra which says that Artha ikatvat ekam vakyam sakanksham chet vibhagya syat. So, very first instance of the word Akanksha was found in Gemini's Mimamsa Sutra, where he mentions that a group of words forms a sentence if, when separated, the words have mutual expectancy and it serves a single purpose. Nayayikas, they again further commented on Akanksha. According to Nayayikas, Akanksha is the syntactic expectancy a word has in order to correlate with another. So, for example, you have the word dwaram, which consists of two parts, prakriti and pratyaya, dwara and am. Dwara denotes an object in the real world, whereas am is the suffix, and this am actually has an expectancy of a verb whose karma can be dwara. So, when we come across a word dwaram, then there is an expectancy, and that expectancy is because of the word am, because of the suffix am. Similarly, suppose we say close or pidehi. Now, what is to be close? There is an expectancy for the verb. So, these expectancies, these are the syntactic expectancies. These are again of two types. One is utthita and the other one is utthapyakanksha. The example of utthita akanksha is for pidehi, there is an expectancy what is to be closed, and in case of dwaram, because there is this dvitiya vibhakti, there is an expectancy what is to be done with this. So, there is an expectancy for a verb, and such a expectancy here is mutual. For pidehi, there is an expectancy for an object, and for this suffix there is an expectancy for a verb, and such an expectancy is called niyata akanksha. Whereas utthapya akanksha is a niyata, or it is unilateral. For example, visheshana, when I say a white cow, white has an expectancy for certain object, cow, dravya, but cow does not have an expectancy for white. Similarly, when I have something like Ramasya, then there is an expectancy, Ramasya kim, Ramasya pustakam. But if I just say pustakam, then whose book it is, there is no expectancy. So, this expectancy is unilateral. Now, why I am giving all these details? Because I will be now using these concepts. These concepts, I will tell you how I was benefited with when I was developing a parser. The second concept in Shabdabodha, in understanding the text, is that of yogyata. Yogyata is the meaning congruity or suitability or mutual compatibility of meanings. Say for example, we have a sentence payasa sinchati, wets with water. The sentence is grammatically correct and we understand. Agnina sinchati, again it's grammatically correct, but then when we have a sentence such as wets with fire, then though it is not ungrammatical, it's not a prama, fine. So it's not a valid cognition. So there is a difference between these. In one case there is a yogyata satisfaction, whereas here the yogyata is not satisfied, because for wetting we need some dravya, and fire is not drava, and fire is not a drava. So in these two sentences, Nayayikas will say Payasa Sinchati is okay because that is Prama also. Whereas Vayakaranas, for Vayakaranas, both the sentences are acceptable. The second one is also considered to be, it's grammatically correct sentence, so they will consider it as a valid sentence grammatically. Mimamsakas, if we look at, they do not differ from Vayakaranas. There is again Shlokavartika, Kumaril Bhatt says, Atyanta asati apihi, arthe jnanam shabdaha karotihi. Abadhattu prama, pramam, atra svataha pramanya nishchalam. So, when the meanings are inconsistent, then there is lack of yogyata among the meanings, but still overall meaning is conceivable. We can imagine the meaning, and that's why if we have the sentence like he is agnina sinchati, saha agnina sinchati, we will at the most laugh, but still we understand the sentence, and since we understand the sentence, we laugh at it. Okay. And when the meanings are consistent, then of course it also leads to a valid cognition. Then the third concept is that of sannidhi or the proximity, and here there are various definitions given. I would like to look at sannidhi as the presentation of word meanings without any intervention. And Nayayikas give one example. Vishwanath Panchanand, for example, has given an example where there is a sannidhi violation. Girihi bhuktam agniman devadattena. So, it's girihi agniman and bhuktam devadattena. So, we see that there is a crossing. There is intervention of the word bhuktam in between girihi agniman, which are related, and the intervention of agniman between bhuktam and devadattena, which are related. And therefore, we find it difficult to understand this sentence. The fourth factor important for verbal cognition is tatparya. Tatparya is the intention of the speaker. And here, well, of course, the tatparya is also understood as meaning of a sentence, as what a speaker intends, okay? But the Mimamsakas may not agree with this, because for Mimamsakas, there is no reference to the speaker. When they are interpreting Vedas, there is no speaker as such. So, the tatparya, further these Nayayikas have classified them further, and they have also discussed what are the factors that are essential in order to understand the meaning, etc. Later on, Alankarikas also have included the suggestive meaning in Tatparya. So, for example, if you have the sentence Gatostam Arkaha, then it may mean for a child, it is time to stop playing and go home. And for a Brahmin, it may be Sandhya Vandana Samay. Or for a young person, it may be time to meet a lover. So, it all depends on in which context the sentence is being uttered. Now, since Yogyata and Tatparya involve word meaning, we will also, let us look at the Indian theories of word meanings briefly. The word and its meaning, the relation between them, are classified into three categories. The meaning is either a primary or secondary, or there may be a suggestive meaning, vyanjana. So, abhidha, lakshana and vyanjana. Abhidha again, it's a conventional that I name this child as Devadatta or I call this a pen. Then it may be etymological, where derivationally the word meaning gets from its components when it is a derived word, or sometimes it may be a compositional but restricted by convention, as in Pankaja, etc. Or you may have both etymological, that is the compositional meaning, as well as the conventional meaning simultaneously. So, both the meanings are available. Lakshana is something which is different from primary meaning. but still it is related to the primary meaning. For example, when we have Gangayam Ghoshaha, then the city on the Ganges, so it is not on the Ganges but on the banks of Ganges. So Ganga, the meaning of Ganga is extended to the banks of the Ganges, Ganga Tira. And in case of Vyangyartha, as we have seen, there is of course no boundary as such, there is no extension, well defined rules etc. for extending the meaning, and it's just limited by poet's imagination. And thus, in case of Vyangyartha, for different listeners, the same sentence may give different meanings. And now let me explain how these concepts, Akanksha, Yogyata, Sannidhi and Tatparya, and that of Abhidha, Lakshana, Vyanjana, were useful for me while doing the processing. What Akanksha tells me is, where the problem is, we have sentences and we need to understand those sentences. So given a sentence, the very first thing I need to do is establish relations between words so that I can understand the meaning of the sentence. So suppose I have a sentence like Ramaha Vanam Gacchati, then what is the relation of Ramaha with Gacchati, Vanam with Gacchati, etc. So first thing I need to know is where is the relation coded, whether it is coded directly or indirectly, and what name should I give to these relations. So these are the three questions which arise in my mind if I need to parse a given sentence. Now for clues for extracting the relations are very clear. Whatever may be the language, you have the abhihitatva, agreement, then vibhakti, sometimes position, as in case of English, or some indeclinables, or the gender number person agreement, or sometimes there are nitya sambandhas, etc. So these are various clues which Panini has discussed in his grammar. So from these clues, I know how to extract the relations. Then the next question is, are these relations always expressed explicitly, or are there cases where the relations are also expressed implicitly? Because if the information is explicit, it is very easy to extract. If it is implicit, then I need to infer. And so there is one more extra process of inference and then extract the relation. So there is an extra step involved. And here is an example, Ramaha Dugdham Pitva Shalam Gacchati. After drinking milk, Ram goes to school. And here Panini gives a sutra, Samana Kartruka Yoho Purva Kale. So use this tva suffix when there is Samana Karta. So now the question is, when I am analyzing it, by looking at tva, should I mark the relation between Ramaha and Pitva and Ramaha and Gacchati, or should I mark just Ramaha and Gacchati, and Ramaha and Pitva is to be inferred from this, because the information is not there directly here marked with any suffix. And here Bhartruhari's Karika helps me. Bhartruhari's Karika says that Pradhanetayoho yatra dravyasya kriyayoho prithak shaktihi gunashraya tatra pradhanam anuruddhyate. Pradhana Vishaya Shaktihi Pratyayena Abhidhiyate Yada Gune Tada Tadvat Anukta Api Prakashate. So Anukta Api, even if it is not said, it gets manifested. So in case X is an argument of both the main verb as well as the subordinate, it is the main verb which assigns the case, and the relation of this X to the subordinate verb gets manifested even without any other marking. So that means there is implicit information, this is not marked explicitly, and this information is very much essential because different languages may code this information in different way. So if I am translating, say, from Sanskrit to English, and if English is not marking this information, then if I mark it while translating, it may mislead. And therefore, it is very much essential to know which information is explicit and which is implicit. So here we say that Ramaha dugdham pitva shalam gachati or Ramena dugdham pitva shala gamyate. Here pitva remains same, Ramaha Ramena change because of these, because there is an agreement here, and this because of anabhihite here you get tritiya, but pitva is not changed. So this relation between Ramaha and pitva is something which needs to be inferred from Panini's sutra. And this is third sutra, one more sutra by Panini, Svatantra Karta, and that tells me how much information is coded in a sentence. Let us look at these sentences. John opened the door with a key, this key opened the door, the wind opened the door, and the door opened. If we look at the Western linguistics, we see that they will call John an agent, this key an instrument, the wind as a cause, and the door as the goal. But in Paninian framework, all of them are karta. And in fact, this is the only information which we can extract from this sentence. If we look at the sentence, and the suffixes that are attached, if we look at the Sanskrit sentences or even in English, these are all in subject position, and there is an agreement between the subject and the verb. If we take the present tense, John opens the door, this key opens, the wind opens, etc. So the in Paninian framework, all of them are karta. So what Panini is saying is, only relation that you can extract from these sentences is the relation of karta. If you want to assign the role of agent to John, then you should know something more about it. Just looking at the padas, not the padartha. Looking at the padas, what can be extracted is the kartrutva. In order to assign agenthood to John, or calling this key as an instrument, what we need to know is also the padartha, and the you should have also the word knowledge. So in other words, what Panini is saying is, he is identifying exactly how much information is coded in a language string, or in other words, he is giving the upper bound for the possible analysis using only language string and grammar without looking at the padartha or the word knowledge, etc. So in other words, I know that if I need to name the relations, I should name the relation as karta, I should not name it as agent, instrument, etc. Once I name it as karta, karma, etc., then that is what I can extract from the language string. But then, if I have a sentence, this key opened the door, and I call it karta, does it matter? Yes, it will matter if I need to do more analysis, something related to the logical analysis, etc. There I need to go for instrument and such type of relations. But in order to mark the relation between this key and open as instrument, as an instrument relation, I need to know more about the process of opening, who are all possible instruments, and so on. So we need more word knowledge to do this kind of analysis. So we can extract precisely only that information which can be decoded from the language string without any requirement of additional knowledge. So this is something like, if we go back to the thermodynamics age of steam engines, at that time there was lot of enthusiasm among the researchers. They thought, now we can convert energy from one to the other form, but no, they later on knew that there is loss of energy also when you convert it from one to the other form. Similarly here, when we are translating, doing machine translation, there is loss of information when we go from one language to the other. If we are trying to extract more information than which exists in the language stream. Now coming to the yogyata part, yogyata is between the word meanings. So the question is, which meaning is captured by yogyata, or what is the level of signification? Is it the literal meaning or the abhida or the primary meaning, or can we extract metaphoric meanings also, or can we also deal with the suggestive meanings? And here again, there is one nyaya of Mimamsa, which says, of the senses, namely mukhya and gauna, it is only the mukhya which is to be accepted as being conveyed by the mantra, and it alone has to be connected with the enjoined act, which when applied to similar case means that words, as far as possible, must be understood as conveying their mukhyartha only. So in other words, just use abhidha. But then they also have something to say about lakshana. Lakshana is resorted only as a means to avoid anarthakya dosha. So suppose agnina sinchati is there, and we do not understand the meaning of the sentence agnina sinchati, or vanam gachati, where vana in the sense of karta, if we do not understand, then vana we consider as people staying in the vana, okay? Or in case of agnina sinchati, even in Hindi we say aag pakhad raha hai, okay? So there then you have to use lakshana to understand the meaning of agnina sinchati. So this lakshana is resorted only as a means to avoid anarthakya dosha. Somebody is saying it, knowing the meanings of agni as well as sinchana kriya, when somebody is saying agnina sinchati, that means he has something to say. And then you try to extend the meaning, and this anarthakya dosha can be, so lakshana is resorted only if the literal sense is found to be unsuitable in the context, and that too only as the last resort. So we go to lakshana only when abhida fails, and for lakshana there are certain conditions. We cannot use, we cannot extend the meaning as per our wish, but there are three conditions. First condition is primary meaning should be inapplicable, unsuitable. Then there should be possibility of some relation between primary meaning and the referent. When we say Gangayam Ghoshah, or the city on the Ganges, then Ganga can be extended to Ganga Tira, because Ganga and Ganga Tira, they are related. Okay? So we can extend the meaning only in a certain direction. And further, there should be sanction for the transferred sense of sense by popular usage. There should be some popular usage. Then only you can use, you can extend the meaning. And regarding the suggestive meaning, since suggestive meaning is different for different listeners, so it is impossible to process the suggestive meaning objectively. And this means the suggestive meaning exists in addition to the primary or the secondary meaning. So they are parallel, okay? So that means, since we cannot process this meaning objectively, we cannot compute it, or computer cannot process the suggestive meaning. Just 3 more minutes. So what we understand is, we use abhidha for analysis. In case abhidha fails to give any analysis, then we use lakshana, and it is impossible to process the suggestive meaning objectively. So at the level of meaning analysis, this puts an upper limit on the meaning that can be extracted from a language tree. So we have seen, we have upper limit on the relation that can be extracted and upper limit on the meaning that can be extracted. In case we want to extract something extra, such as I said, the agenthood or the instrument, etc. If we want to mark such relations, we need to provide more information, and that information comes in the form of big data, which Professor was talking in the morning. And finally, the concept of sannidhi. Sannidhi is characterized as there are no cross-linking of relations when words are presented in linear order. We saw the sentence where we have Girihi Agniman and Guptam Devadattena. So there was crossing. And in fact, this is very it is very interesting to note. We looked at all the shlokas from Bhagavad Gita. And in Bhagavad Gita, we didn't find, we didn't come across any such crossings, even though it is in shloka form, except in case of adjectives and genitives, which again are the Uttapya Akanksha. They don't come under the Uttita Akanksha. So what does this mean? Always we hear that Sanskrit is free word order and so on. So if there are five words, then 5 factorial combination should be possible, okay, if it is a free word order. But no, this sannidhi puts a constraint. Sannidhi says that there cannot be crossings when the words are put in linear order, when crossings between the relations. So there is this constraint, and this constraint has been well recognized by our ancestors in the form of sannidhi. So these 3 factors, akanksha, yogyata, sannidhi, and of course tatparya, I don't have time to talk about it. So these 3 factors, they gave us upper limits as well as restrictions on the sentence, the word order in the sentence. So in other words, they tell us what is possible with machine and what is not possible with machine just by looking at the string, not at the padartha. And once we look at the padartha, for example, the Vaisheshik classification, and look at the yogyata between the word meanings, etc., then little more can be achieved. But there is an upper limit. Some of the things we can never do. For example, the vyangyartha is impossible. And finally, there is this, I stop with this hymn from Rigveda, which Mahabhashyakar also quotes. He distinguishes between a man who understands only literary meaning and a man who understands suggestive meaning as well. So the former sees but does not see, he hears but does not hear, while to the latter speech reveals himself completely, like a loving wife to her husband. So I stop here, and thank you for giving me the opportunity.
Any questions from the audience?
Sanskrit language, order.
Yes. Yeah.
For example, Ramaha varam gachati, gachati yes. Vanam Ramaha.
Yes.
That gives meaning.
Yeah.
But in other languages, in English, Rama goes to forest, forest goes to Rama, that it will be the meaningless sentence. In some sentences, like Guruhu Adnyam Vidnyam Karoti, there is a sentence. If we change the order, Guruhu Vidnyam Adnyam Karoti,
So there are certain cases where the word
order should be
It is important. Yes.
Ma'am, see in Lakshana you said the one particular area in particular that you said context where it says particularly the Lakshana. Okay. context, unsuitable in the context. Mukhyartha badaha. Mukhyartha badhe tadyoge ruditaha prayojana. Srikritam iti manye. See, mukhyartha badaha. So you have to really go into semantical analysis, isn't it?
Yes.
Not just syntax.
Right. So that's why.
How do you do this semantical analysis is the question.
Yeah. So for that we need to look at the, now see, when machine is doing this, the question is how we can get it done by machine, right? For a human being, human beings understand what the padarthas are in the real world. But for a machine, how to get it done? So what we do is, instead of the padarthas, we then look at various properties of the padarthas, right? So the for example, the Vaisheshik ontology we look at, whether it is a dravya guna, that sapta padartha classification.
Would
so
it becomes very complex for every word.
Yes, that needs to be done. Yes. But then there are other ways of doing it. Now big data is being used and they do it.
Unfortunately we don't have a big corpus to do that.
Big corpus with analysis. That we do not have.
Thank you, Professor, for a very, very cautious, very nuanced talk. I have a toy example, and I want to see if this kind of vivaksha will be able to catch the ambiguity that will happen in such an example. If we took a sentence like Ramah snatva Ravanam hanti, and if there was some looseness in terms of word order allowed, and if you converted this into passive voice, and if you said Ramena snatva Ravanaha hanyate. Now, is the connection of snatva with Ravana or Rama in the second sentence? How will we be able to figure that out? Is snatva qualifying Ravana or Rama when you have Ramena snatva Ravanaha hanyate? How will we be able to disambiguate that?
Here it's not possible. See, if for a human being it is not possible, for a machine it is not possible. Right? If you can give me algorithm, I will implement it. So the sentence which you have said is ambiguous. No, not for karma. No. In case of karmani, so only karta gets shared. Whether it is kartari or karmani, karta gets shared. Okay. And this is the problem. In English, it is not possible, whereas in Sanskrit, it is possible. Yeah. So in this case, it will. So in this case, it will be Rama who is the karta for snatva.
Ma'am, one of the slides you show that we can make the meaning and we can laugh on that, right? One initial in the slides, right?
Yes.
So because we understand the meaning of that.
Yeah.
So my question is, though there are Hindi Kavya or Sanskrit Kavya, you know, the Mahakavi and all those. So what are your thoughts, the anatomy of a prose or not prose, anatomy of a laughter or humor per se?
Huh?
So is it like, order is not relevant in some cases. So in the ancient text or the now in your research, I want to understand that if we just change the order or the semantic meaning of it, then what induces laughter or not laughter per se, humor, because humor is highly intellectual form, so not like jokes. So is there a interplay of order or semantics, which is not a prose form, it is coming from a, sorry, poem form, it is coming from a text or prose form which induces humor. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, typically the humor is because you are using words from different categories. You are, something is expected and you are using something which is unexpected. So, there are several examples. If I remember correctly, while developing WordNet, Professor Mallar Kulkarni came up with several such examples where if the word belongs to some different category, then it results in laughter. So, basically it is the categorization, classification. Now, this classification is semantic classification. So, it may be the padartha classification of Vaisheshika or something more than that.
Thank you, ma'am. I now request Professor Gopinath to honor ma'am.
Well, just can I take one more minute if you don't mind? Yeah, sure. Those who are interested, we have these tools available on our University of Hyderabad website. The name is Sausadhani, and here you have various tools such as morphological analyzer, etc., or even generator, and given a sentence, machine can also produce the parsed analysis. So all these are available. I won't take much time of yours. You can, those who are interested can have a look at this website and give me feedback on this. So whatever I spoke today, all these constraints have been incorporated while developing these tools. Thank you.
I thank all the participants for their enthusiastic participation today. See you all tomorrow morning at 9 a.m.
Retired. 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 Retired